Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The Quarter Life Breakthrough. Invent your own path, find meaningful work, and build a life that matters. By Adam Smiley Poswolsky. Introduction. My Quarter Life Breakthrough. How we spend our days is, of course, how we spend our lives. Annie Dillard. Have you ever known that you needed to make a change, but were completely unable to do anything about it? Have you ever felt like you were physically paralyzed by life, like you were trapped in a room and you couldn't get out? That's exactly how I felt for almost 2 years at my job at the Peace Corps headquarters in Washington, D.C. On paper, and to the rest of the world, the job was perfect. I worked as a special assistant to the director of global operations and later was promoted to a program specialist. I got to sit in on senior staff meetings, draft important memos, and sometimes write remarks for the director of the Peace Corps. Once, I traveled to Botswana and worked with the Secret Service to help plan Michelle Obama's visit with Peace Corps volunteers. The job had promotion potential. I was making $70,000 a year at the age of 28. I had the best healthcare plan in the country, a matching 401k plan, and long-term job security. My boss told me I was doing a great job and that I was indispensable to the team. My parents were proud of me. When people at happy hour asked me the DC requisite, "So, what do you do?" they were always impressed when I showed them my fancy business card and told them I worked at the Peace Corps. Everything was perfect about my job, except for one tiny, very important thing. I was miserable. Every time my alarm went off in the morning, I'd feel a shooting pain go up and down my back. I used to call this pain my morning edition because it coincided with NPR waking me up. "It's morning edition for NPR News. I'm Steve Inskeep." "And I'm Renee Montaigne. Yesterday, the Senate blocked a measure to expand background checks for gun buyers and ban assault weapons, despite the recent tragedy at Sandy Hook Elementary School." My morning edition would shoot up and down my back when I was tying my tie before leaving the house, riding the bus down 16th Street to work, and when I scan my ID badge in on the way to the office. I feel it on the elevator ride upstairs, in weekly team meetings when we went over bullet-pointed to-do lists and discussed best practices, and when I was out at a bar with friends, feeling my BlackBerry vibrate with an email from my boss at 10 p.m. The pain, which manifested itself physically as shingles on my side, a stress-related nerve disease common among 75-year-olds, not 28-year-olds, was actually far worse emotionally. It was the pain of knowing I wasn't where I was meant to be, but having no clue where I needed to go or how to get there. It was the pain of thinking something was wrong with me for having this great job that I wasn't energized by, a job that seemingly everyone else in my life was thrilled I had. It was the pain of not being satisfied with working at the Peace Corps, a place that was making a positive impact in the world, whose mission was to promote world peace and friendship. I knew I wanted to help others, but if I wasn't happy at the Peace Corps, where the hell would I be satisfied working? It was the fear that I might never make a change and be stuck forever in a job that wasn't right for me. It was the stress of not knowing the answers, what some people call a quarter-life crisis, although I certainly don't wish shingles upon the 50 million 20-somethings out there. For over a year, I lived with my quarter-life crisis before I actually did anything about it. The experience was crippling. It was like my life was on hold. Being unhappy at work affected my ability to make simple decisions like what to eat for dinner or what to watch on Netflix. Every time I went to Target, I faced an existential crisis because I didn't know whether I should buy a small or big bottle of shampoo in case I decided to quit my job and move. Receiving my monthly billing statement from Sallie Mae in my inbox made me want to throw my computer out the window. Looking at job postings on Idealist stressed me out because I had no idea what I was looking for. Seeing the cover of self-help books like "What Color Is Your Parachute?", "You Majored in What?", and "Life's a Bitch and Then You Change Careers" overwhelmed me and made me nauseated. I had a pile of career change books that I kept zipped up in a suitcase in the back of my closet because it scared me so much just to look at them. At night, I scrolled through my Facebook newsfeed and saw all my friends' lives unfolding, and I was jealous. I wanted to be wherever they were, doing whatever they were doing. I'd think to myself, maybe I should move to Thailand. Maybe I should get my MBA. Maybe I should start my own nonprofit. Maybe I should work at a charter school. Maybe I should open my own food truck, even though I don't know how to cook and I'm the world's worst driver. Maybe I should start an organic farm, even though I don't really like the smell of compost. Maybe I should get married and have kids, even though I don't even have a girlfriend. A friend of mine from college had already graduated from one of the top law schools in the country, gotten a job at one of New York City's top corporate law firms, making over $150,000 a year. And there he was on Instagram, traveling with his girlfriend in Peru, proposing at sunset in front of Machu Picchu. I was like, this guy. He's already got a law degree and an amazing job. He's getting engaged to a beautiful woman. I hate my job. I hate my life. I can't even get a date on OkCupid. My life is ruined. I'm done for. I'd lie in bed, unable to fall asleep. The choices besieged me. I felt helpless and alone. It was only when I met other young people going through the same thing I was going through, minus the shingles, that I realized I wasn't alone and struggling to figure out what to do with my life, and felt empowered to have my breakthrough. I wrote this book to prove it's okay to want something different from what you did 2 years ago. It's okay to leave a job everyone else thinks is awesome, and it's okay not to know exactly what it is you want at the age of 22 or 25 or 30 or at any point. It's okay to invent your own path. In fact, you have to invent your own path. There is not one answer. Everyone is different, and you have to discover what works for you. This is the book I wish I had during my own quarter-life crisis. This is the book I wish someone had handed to me when I graduated from college, headed to the exact same place I was before college, my parents' house. This book is about how a bunch of inspiring 20 and 30-somethings changed my life and how their stories can help change your life, too. We're not the me generation. We're the purpose generation. When I worked at the Peace Corps, I went to a free professional development class the Office of Personnel Management was offering to employees from different government agencies. The class, called Establishing a Business Mindset, was held in a fluorescent-lit basement that smelled like chlorine in an office building somewhere on K Street in downtown Washington, D.C. The facilitator was at least 60 years old, bald and overweight, and wearing a wrinkled gray suit with dirty running shoes. He was chewing on a Subway sandwich when I arrived. This immediately threw me off. Who eats Subway at 9 o'clock in the morning? At the beginning of the class, Mr. Subway asked each of us to introduce ourselves and say why we were there. There were about 10 participants, and I was by far the youngest in the room. One woman answered that she was interested in starting her own internet business on the side. I went next and said, after I leave government, I'm interested in supporting entrepreneurs who are starting ventures that are making a social impact. When I mentioned the words leave government, I could see the eyes rolling in the room and hear someone clear their throat. The guy who went after me said, well, this is a paid staff development day, so I don't have to be in the office, which means I'm one day closer to retirement. Of the people that followed, several had exactly the same answer. Another said, I'm not at work. Hallelujah. I was surprised at how many people would attend a class about personal goal setting just to waste time or check off another day in the long road toward their pension. But when you think about it, you can't blame them. This is how many of us are told to live our lives, either from our family or the media or even friends. This is the traditional American dream retirement mindset we learn from a young age. Go to college, climb the ladder, find a well-paying job that allows you to support a family, retire at 65, and you'll be fulfilled. There's one slight problem with the retirement mindset. It doesn't actually lead to fulfillment. Gallup's 2014 State of the American Workplace report showed that as many as 70% of American workers are disengaged at their jobs. Nearly one-fifth of those people were so disengaged at the office that they were actively undermining their coworkers' work. They were literally getting paid to screw things up for their company. If you think it's crazy that millions of people spend their days unfulfilled, not showing up fully for themselves, their families, their companies, their communities, and the causes they believe in, you are not alone. Let me repeat that. You are not alone. I think part of this lack of fulfillment stems from our failure as a society to encourage people to ask themselves simple questions that don't often yield simple answers. Who am I? What do I want? What are my unique gifts? What do I want for the world? What types of people do I want to surround myself with? What is my purpose? Why am I here? Why? I've asked many of my peers why over the last 3 years, And not once has someone answered, make lots of money so I can buy nice stuff, run a corporation so I can have lots of power, or pass the time as quickly as possible, doing as little as possible, so I can retire with a pension in 40 years and go on a cruise with my partner. Rather, they said things like, I want to teach urban teenagers how to avoid debt and become successful entrepreneurs. I want to inspire young girls to think they can become engineers and not Barbie dolls. I want to stop immigrants from getting wrongfully deported and separated from their families. And I want to empower all kids, regardless of what block they were born on, to reach their full potential. Young people aren't waiting for retirement. They're asking what their purpose is now, and they're determined to find the opportunities, organizations, and companies that share their dreams. 90% of millennials want to use their skills for good, and a recent study by Net Impact showed that more than half of millennials would take a 15% pay cut to do work for an organization that matches their values. Deloitte's 2015 Millennial Survey found that nearly 8,000 future leaders from 30 different countries think the business world is getting it wrong. Some 75% say businesses are focused on their own agendas rather than on improving society. In a popular New York Times op-ed titled Millennial Searchers, Emily Esfahani Smith and Jennifer L. Aker argued that millennials appear to be more interested in lives defined by meaning than by what some would call happiness. They report being less focused on financial success than they are on making a difference. In the next 10 years, millennials, in this book, used to describe those born between 1980 and 2000, will make up 75% of the workforce. My generation is not alone in choosing meaning as more important than money in their lives. A recent study by IBM showed that Gen Xers and baby boomers also rank meaning and purpose as a top factor in determining workplace engagement. If the majority of the workforce expects to make a difference through their work, the important question becomes, how do you actually find meaning in the workplace? How do you find work that makes your heart sing, creates impact, and pays your rent? What are the tools and strategies that will help you be effective in achieving your purpose? This book provides inspiring, honest, and counterintuitive career advice for anyone stuck in a quarter-life crisis or third-life crisis or midlife crisis. My mom is 64 and thinks she's having a quarter-life crisis and figuring out what to do with their lives from others who have recently gotten unstuck. Regardless of where you're coming from, there are several assumptions I'm making about where you're going. If any of these assumptions apply to you, this book is for you. First, you refuse to settle for mediocrity. You want to spend your days doing something that inspires you. You're less concerned with impressing your parents, your college professor, or your friends on Facebook, and more interested in pursuing the purpose that burns inside you. Instead of hearing someone else tell you you're successful, you'd rather discover what success means to you. You don't fit into a single box. You can't be defined by your college major, an acronym-prone personality test, a GMAT score, or one career path. Second, you want to make a positive difference in the lives of others. Whether you want to solve a pressing social problem or make someone feel better about her day, you want to make an impact. You want to make a living doing something that matters. You want to dedicate your life to something greater than yourself. And finally, you're prepared to take action. You know that the hardest part is starting the journey, but you're ready to begin making changes now. You want to come alive today, not when you're retired and 65, but right now. You're willing to take baby steps now, to embrace being a lifelong learner now, to create self-care and wellness rituals now, to hustle now, to surround yourself with a community of believers now, to build a career that matters right now. My friend Nate recently left his job to pursue his venture, The Love Youmentary, a podcast and blog that shares stories about true love and healthy relationships. He explains his transition by saying, I'd rather spend my days working on something I feel incredibly inspired by and proud of than to waste them in a job counting down the minutes till I can go home. I decided that if I didn't like my life how it was my job to change it, and so I did. We spend nearly half our waking lives working. This book is for everyone who feels like Nate, who wants to reach their potential, spend their days working with purpose, and find meaningful work as opposed to mediocre work. Mediocre work is a job that pays the bills. It's something that passes the time, work you're not fully engaged with or interested in, for a cause or company that doesn't align with what you care about. Mediocre work may add to your financial well-being, but doesn't allow you to make your unique contribution to the world. In contrast, this book contends that meaningful work provides personal meaning, reflecting who you are and what your interests are, allows you to share your gifts to help others, provides a community of believers that will support your dreams, and is financially viable given your desired lifestyle. I'll spend time later on in this book dissecting this definition and having you create a specific definition of what meaningful work is for you. Viktor Frankl's best-selling and still relevant book, Man's Search for Meaning, is about his experience in a Nazi concentration camp, during which he lost his pregnant wife and most of his family. Frankl wrote, "Being human always points and is directed to something or someone other than oneself, be it a meaning to fulfill or another human being to encounter. The more one forgets himself by giving himself to a cause to serve or another person to love, the more human he is." Although there are multiple ways to define meaning, I interpret Frankl's words to define meaning as something that comes not from personal gain, but from service or companionship, from positively impacting the lives of others. Let's be real. It's hard enough for young people to find any job in today's job market. Finding meaningful work is even more challenging. According to the Pew Research Center, nearly half of American adults ages 18 to 24 are jobless, the highest unemployment percentage since the government began collecting data 60 years ago. The U.S. non-employment rate among 25 to 34-year-olds, which includes the unemployed and those who have dropped out of the labor force, is over 25%. Since 1983, the year I was born, the average net worth of someone between the ages of 29 and 37 has fallen more than 20%. One in four adults between 18 and 34 years old say they have moved back in with their parents after living on their own. Breaking from tradition, our generation may grow up to be less wealthy than our parents' generation. Every generation probably feels like it's gotten the short end of the stick, but critics really love to hate on millennials. They call us the lazy generation, the entitled generation, and the me generation. Based on the young people I know and the ones you'll read about in this book, these stereotypes couldn't be further from the truth. Millennials want to work, and despite being shackled by debt, recession, and the job crisis, they aren't motivated by money. Rather, they're driven to make the world more compassionate, innovative, and sustainable. We aren't the me generation. We are the purpose generation, and we will be engaged with our work because we have to be. The challenges facing our generation are simply too serious to ignore. They're too serious to only worry about on the weekends or after 5 p.m. We are a group of determined individuals who refuse to settle because we know how great our impact can be when we find work we truly care about. Most books and articles about 20-somethings focus on the problem. Why we are doomed, in debt, depressed, lazy, unlucky, entitled, or addicted to Facebook. Instead, I am writing about the solution, so that anyone going through a quarter-life crisis can turn a moment of being stuck into a breakthrough, a moment of opportunity and possibility when you discover why you're doing what you're doing and what you want to give to the world. As part of my journey over the last 3 years, I became a Starting Block Fellow, completing a program that trains emerging leaders to drive social innovation across sectors and fosters a tight-knit community of changemakers in 55 countries. I directed the Bold Academy, an intensive residential leadership development program for young professionals interested in finding clarity, building confidence, and working with purpose. I also facilitated and ran community engagement efforts for the Hive Global Leaders Program, which has trained more than 500 purpose-driven leaders and entrepreneurs from 60 countries who are all working on creating a better world. During this time, I've interviewed and met with hundreds of highly motivated millennials. Some of them quit their jobs to start their own ventures. Some now work for the world's most innovative companies, and some are still figuring out the next step in their breakthroughs. My goal in capturing these stories was to discover how we can each get a little bit closer to knowing why we're doing what we're doing and take action toward reaching our potential. In the summer of 2013, my own breakthrough swung into full gear as I self-published the beta version of the book I'm reading to you right now. Without much of a platform and seeking to practice writing, I ran a crowdfunding campaign for the book, which raised nearly $13,000 for more than 500 people in 40 countries. It turned out that a lot of 20-somethings were struggling to find meaningful work, just like me. When I told a friend that I was writing a book, he said, "I'm pretty sure that book has already been written like 100 times by people a lot smarter than you. You're just wasting your time." I learned one important lesson early on in my journey. Always ignore people who tell you not to pursue your dreams. Almost everything has already been done, but it hasn't been done by you, and that's all that matters. In the spring of 2014, my self-published version of The Quarter Life Breakthrough became a bestseller and the number one top-rated job hunting book on Amazon, and paved the way for this book. This book is a new and improved version of my self-published book. It shares inspiring stories of many 20 and 30-somethings who are figuring out how to work with purpose and still pay their rent. It also tells my own story of how I escaped shingles and Facebook-induced FOMO, fear of missing out, grew my following from one subscriber, my mom, to several friends, to thousands of readers, and built a fulfilling and financially sustainable career around something I care deeply about, empowering my generation to pursue work that matters. The goal of this book is to help you find purposeful work, work that makes you come alive and feel excited to start your day, even on a Monday morning, or at least most Monday mornings. Reading this book will help you get a little closer to who you are and discovering what your next step might be in the context of building a purposeful career. That next step might be quitting your current job, finding a new job, changing jobs within your company, or embarking on an entirely new career path. It might be deciding whether to go to graduate school, pursue a side project you've been dreaming about, launch a crowdfunding campaign, or start your own business. The next step might seem small at first. Experimenting with things that interest you, learning a new skill, and finding communities who will hold you accountable to your dreams. Or it might mean accepting that you don't know what the next step will be. This book won't tell you what you should do with your life. How would I know? I've never even met you. It won't tell you to find the perfect job. How is it possible to know what your perfect job is before you lived your life? What happens if the perfect job doesn't exist for you, but the right job does? It won't tell you to find your true calling. Nobody has only one calling. Even the so-called gurus who write books about finding your true calling have at least six callings, trust me. It won't tell you to quit your job, follow your passion, and live happily ever after. We'll discover that this cliche is actually rather crappy career advice, and that most people who find meaning do not quit their jobs right away, but instead save money, invest in their skills, experiment with side projects, and hustle for months and sometimes even for years while flirting with things that make them rather uncomfortable in order to achieve their dreams. It won't tell you to do what you love. We'll learn that most people who find meaningful work worry less about what they love and more about their purpose, the unique contribution they can make to the world, and how they can serve the people they love. And it won't tell you to work only 4 hours a week. Why would you want to avoid something that might fulfill you? Why would you want to automate something that could give you joy? Why would you want to escape those who need your help? This book will simply empower you to get closer to finding a job or opportunity that allows you to share your gifts and make a positive impact in the lives of others. It will help you build a career and a life that matters. Finding meaningful work is by no means easy, but it's not impossible either. Unlike 70% of Americans, the millennials profiled in this book are excited about how they spend their days. They've done everything from teach fourth graders math, to join the foreign service, leave a nonprofit for a tech company, and leave a tech company for a nonprofit, and tons more in between. Any kind of work can be meaningful. The challenge is discovering what in particular makes you come alive. Finding meaningful work requires asking many personal questions before it rewards any answers. Finding the work that makes you come alive is all about alignment and fit. What works for your friend may not work for you. You can have the wrong job at the right organization, or the right job at the wrong organization, or even the wrong job at the wrong organization. Additionally, your purpose is constantly evolving as you learn new things, travel to new places, make new friends, start families, raise children, build communities, and grow older. What was purposeful for you 1 year may no longer be purposeful for you a few years later. This book is divided into three parts, reflecting three stages in any quarter life breakthrough. In part one, you'll start by taking small steps to invent your own path. I'll share the story of how I've had 10 jobs since college and argue that climbing a career ladder limits the potential for risk-taking and experimentation and is impractical in today's rapidly evolving and unstable job market. Instead of moving up and down on a career ladder defined by someone else's version of success, we'll think of careers as a series of lily pads extending in all directions, which allow you to jump to any new project or opportunity based on your purpose. You'll embrace the journey by moving beyond FOMO, listening when a light goes off telling you something isn't right, and using fear to guide you in the right direction. In part two, you'll create your own definition of meaningful work. You'll discover how to align your work with your purpose and how to kickstart your job search by trying on jobs to see if they fit through short-term experiences and side projects. We'll talk about balancing money and meaning and how to determine your breakthrough priorities. If graduate school is on your radar, we'll find out from several recent law school and business school graduates how to figure out whether grad school is worth it for you and whether now is the right time for you to go back to school. And finally, in part three, you'll get your breakthrough hustle on and take action toward getting what you want. You'll start by practicing self-love and prioritizing the things that make you happy. You'll do short exercises that will help you go outside your comfort zone and accomplish your goals. You'll brainstorm ways to invest in your breakthrough and build a supportive community of believers who share your values. Based on the stories of people like you who have recently had breakthroughs, you'll learn useful lessons in breakthrough hustling that will help you make an impact today and leave a legacy going forward. An introduction wouldn't be complete without a few important caveats. Life is more than what you do. We live in a society that likes to define us by our job titles, how much money we make, who we know, and how cool our business cards look. While I lived in Washington, D.C., I grew accustomed to answering the requisite, "So, what do you do?" wherever I went. In fact, I once met a woman at happy hour who asked me for my business card before she even shook my hand or got my name, as if our interaction hinged on my job title. I hated answering this question for a couple of reasons. First, because telling someone, "I'm the special assistant to the director of global operations at the U.S. Peace Corps," kind of made me feel like Dwight Schrute talking to Michael Scott on The Office. Second, because it didn't really describe who I was. It left out all the fun stuff, like the fact that my favorite thing to do in the world is sip green tea and write in my Moleskine, or that if it was up to me, I'd eat a bagel with lox and cream cheese every meal for the rest of my life, or that I've seen every single episode of Seinfeld 14 times and cannot have a conversation, even on a date, without busting into my Kramer voice, "Oh, I'm stressed." Telling someone what I did for a living also didn't describe the people in my life who I love most. It left out my role model, my younger sister, who I talk to every day about life decisions as serious as whether she should go to graduate school and as trivial as whether it's appropriate for me to wear running shoes on an OkCupid date. My job title doesn't include how grateful I am for my friends, who make me laugh so hard I usually end up on the floor whenever I'm with them. What you do matters. That's why you're reading this book. But life is more than a job. The time we spend outside the office, doing things we love with people we care about, is where many find fulfillment. However, since I'm 32 years old, live with five roommates in an apartment with an ant problem, recently attended a singles yoga class, and I'm still wearing running shoes and talking like Kramer on dates, I decided to write this book about something I can actually speak to, my journey over the last 10 years to find meaningful work. Having said that, I hope that some of the strategies to plan your breakthrough and become mindful about how you spend your days will bring you closer to the types of people and experiences that provide true joy and fulfillment inside and outside the workplace. Meaningful work is a rare privilege. Everyone deserves the chance to find meaningful work. Everyone. However, the harsh reality is that most people wake up every day without the ability to decide what they do for a living. More than 2 billion people globally live on less than $2 a day. At least 1.2 billion people live in extreme poverty, lacking access to basic needs like clean drinking water, food, and sanitation services. Millions more, including in the United States, where 14.5% of the population, some 45 million Americans, live below the poverty line, lack the financial ability, the access to education and healthcare, civil and human rights, or the physical freedom to make these choices. Being able to choose what you do with your life is an enormous privilege, and it shouldn't be wasted. This doesn't mean that everyone who went to college and owns a MacBook should rush off to work in an impoverished African village, or that people with relative means are necessarily happier than people without. Some research suggests otherwise. But it does mean that those of us fortunate enough to decide what we do should think deeply about what we care about, how we want to use the time we have, and how we can each leave this world a little bit better than we found it. My friend Nikita Mitchell put it far better than I can. Nikita graduated from UC Berkeley's Haas School of Business, where she became the first Black woman ever to serve as president of the school's MBA association. Passionate about diversity and gender issues, Nikita was concerned that her business school class was only 29% women and that she was one of only three Black women in the entire class. Nikita and a group of her classmates launched an effort to work with the Haas administration and admissions office to recruit more women MBAs, and in just 1 year, helped increase the percentage of women in Haas's first year MBA class to 43%, making it the business school with one of the largest percentages of female students in the country. And it didn't stop there. They ultimately created an initiative that has since been passed down to new student leaders, outlining a vision for creating a more inclusive culture for women who attend business school. It is the greatest gift to be able to stop and think about what you want, Nikita told me. It is the epitome of privilege. You have to have the money, the resources, and the time that most people in this world just don't have. When you've been given that kind of privilege, and you've been given the kind of education I've been given, the kind of resources I've been given, it would basically be throwing away all of the sacrifices that my parents made to come to this country, to put me through school, all of the things that my ancestors have fought for, if I didn't stop and think about what matters to me and what I should contribute to the world. All work can be meaningful. There is a widespread misconception that only certain jobs are meaningful. The types of jobs you read about in business self-help books like this one. Jobs in fields like social entrepreneurship, tech, poverty alleviation, healthcare, education, media, and the arts. The truth is that any job can be meaningful. Any job, however unfulfilling to you, might be incredibly meaningful to someone else. During one of my first speaking engagements about how to find meaningful work, I made a comment I now regret. I said, millennials like me don't want to work for meaningless apps that help rich people get their laundry done faster. They want to work for companies that actually change the world. I had just read an article by George Packer in The New Yorker, who was lambasting Silicon Valley, astutely observing that the hottest tech startups are solving all the problems of being 20 years old with cash on hand because that's who thinks them up. I made my comment because I believe my generation is actually looking beyond making on-demand delivery apps for wealthy people and instead using our careers to make a deeper social impact. I no longer make that comment, and here's why. At a speaking engagement a few months later, a man named Nicholas Sanderson came up to me and told me about Laundry Locker, a 10-year-old laundry and dry cleaning business he now runs in San Francisco. Laundry Locker allows people to drop off their dry cleaning and laundry in lockers and then cleans it for them while they are at work. Nicholas told me that many of the individuals he employs come from troubled backgrounds and have had a hard time finding traditional employment. What he finds meaningful is providing them with a stepping stone towards something bigger and better in their careers. These passionate individuals can learn transferable skills and relationship development tactics that make them employable for their next big roles, which in turn is meaningful to them and their families. Never, ever assume that your work is more meaningful than someone else's. Everyone is different, and all work can be meaningful. The challenge is finding what's meaningful to you. Reading this book is just the beginning. The last time I picked up a career change book, I put it down after 2 minutes and hid it in my closet. That terrifying book was 373 pages long, packed with intimidating goal charts and worksheets that looked like something from the SAT, and full of statistics and case studies of how famous rich people like Bill Gates and Mark Zuckerberg started their careers. Instead of writing a book like the one I hid in my closet, I decided to write a short book without too many statistics, but with a lot of fun exercises, helpful resources, and engaging stories of young people figuring out what to do with their lives. Here's how to get the most of this book. Do the exercises. Throughout the book, you'll find practical exercises and reflections intended to help you at each stage of your breakthrough. These are meant to be fun, useful, and as un-SAT as possible. You may find it helpful to have a journal or sketchbook close by in case you want to jot down any ideas. If some of the exercises don't work for you, skip them. Come back to them later. Just don't hide this book in your closet. Share your story. The gifted 20 and 30-somethings whose stories I tell didn't start companies like Microsoft and Facebook. They're not famous, and they're definitely not rich. They're my friends, whom I love, and who have inspired me to dream bigger. All of them are still figuring it out, like you and me. Each has failed and succeeded in some way or another. By the end of this book, I hope you'll share your own narrative of what you want for the world, just like my friends did. Everyone is different. There is no right answer or cure-all when it comes to finding meaningful work. The people who find it are the ones who spend time looking for it. The only person who knows what is right for you is you. No self-help author, especially one nicknamed Smiley, career counselor, life coach, parent, boss, acronym-prone personality test, GRE, LSAT, or GMAT score, or friend's Facebook post can start making these decisions for you. You have to start sometime, so how about right now? Part 1. Invent Your Own Path. Chapter 1. Start Jumping Lily Pads. Not all those who wander are lost. J.R.R. Tolkien. Taped above my desk is an article from The Onion with the headline, 24-year-old receives sage counsel from venerable 27-year-old, and a picture of two 20-somethings in plaid shirts in deep existential conversation over pints of beer at a bar. When I told my dad I was writing a career advice book, he looked at me like I was crazy and asked, "What qualifies you to be writing a book about careers? You change what you want to do with your life."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.